It has been a wonderful morning already here at First Baptist Church of Richlands, and we are excited to continue to worship and explore God's Word together and be in community and fellowship with one another today. Before we get into that, we do have a couple of announcements. If you are a first-time guest, we want to extend to you a very, very special welcome. And if you know anything about us, as you get to know more about us, we love to connect with our visitors. When you came in the front doors or the back doors, you should have seen some blue cards that said connect on them. Myself, Pastor Mike, the staff, we would love to connect with you guys if you'd want us to. If nothing else, send you guys a little note and tell you that we appreciate you and thinking about you and praying for you throughout the week. So I want to encourage you to do that. Cool and new if you're tech savvy. That is pretty cool to me. If you look in your bulletin, there's a little box with some black marks on it. It looks like an alien symbol. It's called a QR code. Now, there's some kind of science that if you take a picture of it, it will send you to a virtual connect card. So if you don't want to fill it out physically, you can type it on your phone and we can connect with you that way and our church office will receive it. So just some cool tech there. Another piece of announcements to this morning. Tonight at 6 o'clock, we have a church conference. We have a lot to go over, church. So if you have time, we're going to encourage you guys to come out. Just a couple of things we're going to be exploring tonight and handling is we're going to be voting on a motion by the nominating committee to hire our financial secretary. We will be presenting our 2021 budget for review. We'll be voting on some bylaw changes. And there's just a ton, so I'm not going to sit here and read everything. So just encourage you to come out at 6 o'clock tonight in the sanctuary. I would love for you guys to be a part of that and to see what's going on here in the life of our church. Something else is exciting that starts today that's going to happen for the next three Sundays. Each week, being a Southern Baptist church, we have major giving opportunities throughout the year. We have our Annie Armstrong giving. We have our Lottie Moon. And then what begins this week is a North Carolina Baptist Missions offering. Traditionally, our church has given to it. If you think about Annie Armstrong and Lottie Moon, it handles international and national ministries that we fund. This North Carolina Baptist Missions offering primarily focuses on missions happening in our state. So when you think of the stuff that is happening, you know, our country is in desperate need to come to know a great God, a great Savior, and that includes our state. And so the giving that we do is going to fund the missionaries and the activities that are going on there. So if you receive giving envelopes in the mail, each quarter you should get a yellow one that says state missions on it. If you want to give physically and drop it in our offering plates at our welcome center, you can just put it in there and it'll go towards our state mission. If you guys give electronically through the app or through the website, there's a drop-down fund that says state missions. And in the weeks to come, we'll have additional yellow fold envelopes if you guys choose to give that way. The goal this year, the statewide goal, is $2.1 million. I would love to see our church take a bite out of that. Missions is very near and dear to my heart, and I would love, as your missions pastor, to see that goal, see our church take a great bite out of that and make that happen. Another piece, and we're winding down here, church directory signups are at the Welcome Center. We have two weekends that are split. The first opportunity to come is October 9th, as well as October 10th. That's a Friday and a Saturday. Those dates are specifically for families. So if you guys have young children, if you guys have teenagers who, you know, typically this service, if you guys would like to come during those times, we'll be in the adult wing doing pictures for our church directory. If you are more on the high-risk side, where you prefer to kind of keep your distance from families and our younger children, we do have a date set up just for you guys. And that will be the following weekend, October 16th. That's a Friday. There's times all throughout the day, starting from the morning into the evening. So if you guys could make it out and make sure you brush your teeth and smile big, it'll be a great picture day. Last piece of announcements, we're going to get to worship today. Believe it or not, pumpkin patch is here. It feels like we're just coming out of summer and then it just decided to get cold on us overnight. But the pumpkin patch is beginning. The pumpkins are going to be delivered October 16th. And the first day of our pumpkin patch will be October 17th. In the past, this has been a wonderful outreach opportunity. It's also gone a very long time. This year, Pastor Mike's going to talk a little more about it later on, but this year it's not going to be as long as far as weeks-wise, but it's also not going to be as long during the day. So I want to encourage you to go check out the sign-ups if you can spare some of your time to work that. It's a wonderful opportunity to get people plugged into our church, to share the gospel with them, and ultimately just love on people during this time. That's enough. So we're going to get to worshiping today. We're going to get to some singing and some opening of God's word. So if you will, let's bow our heads and pray together. Father God, I thank you for who you are. God, I thank you for your love, for your grace, and for your mercy, Lord, that you just lavish upon us each and every day. God, I thank you that, Father, while we were sinners, Father, you sent your son to die on this earth. Father, knowing that we were in desperate need of a Savior, Father, knowing that we were in desperate need of someone to bear our sins and our shame, Father, you came and you died on a cross for each and every one of us. So, Father, as we come before you this morning, God, as we take a moment and just focus on who you are and what you have done, Father, may we understand who we are in light of you. God, we thank you, Lord, that we have this opportunity to lift high your name. God, we thank you for this opportunity to open your word. Father, may it not just fall on our ears. May we not just hear it, but Father, may we listen to it. Father, may we apply it to our lives. And Father, just thank you for allowing us to be part of this mission of the gospel. So God, thank you for this morning. I pray that you'd be with us. And as we go out this week, I pray that we are sent in boldness in your name and your precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. So church, let's stand and let's worship this morning.
I'll fly away. Well, I wandered so aimless, like it was sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. And then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Oh, praise the Lord, I saw the light. Well, I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Well, praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered alone. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. And then like a blind man, I got me back inside. Well, praise the Lord, I saw the light. Here we go. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. And now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. And now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Woo! Amen. So we have a new song this morning that many of you might have heard, but we're excited to lead and to sing. And we sing a song called We Believe that's an older song, and this song mirrors that song pretty well. This song, instead of We Believe, is called This I Believe. And as a church, it is so important as a community that not only in word, but if we have the opportunity to do it in song, we're going to affirm what we believe. And so let's sing these words. This is how the chorus goes. We're going to jump ahead to the chorus, and we'll jump back to the verse. But this is how the chorus goes.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Let's sing that again. I believe.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Sing Our Father Everlasting.
Our Father Everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior.
Sing it out, church, I believe.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, and we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Sing Our Judge.
Our Judge and our Defender, suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. And I believe in you. And I believe you rose again. And I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Sing it again.
Oh, I believe in you. And I believe that you rose again. And I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Father God, we thank you this morning that you came and you rose. And Father, it's in you that we place our hope and our trust this morning. It's in your precious name that we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Every year, Moms in Prayer sponsors Bless Our Schools Sunday. This organization has been in existence for 36 years. It is in all of our 50 states, and it is in 150 countries. Being involved in Moms in Prayer for more than 10 years, I can see why God has so blessed this ministry. Number one, God wants us to pray. And two, moms and grandmothers' hearts beat the same around the world for their children and grandchildren. Weekly, moms and grandmothers gather together to pray for schools and children and adult children and preschooler children. We don't stop any age of our children. Yes, it is a time to pray. And some of you might be thinking, well, that out loud praying frightens me a little bit. But I would like to encourage you, because that's the very reason why this Moms in Prayer opportunity is ideal. Here's what it does. It's a great teaching tool where we learn how to pray effectively, scripturally, and boldly with confidence as we come before the throne of God. Look, I know you can't see this from where you are. I've got copies over there on the table on your way out today. But this is a sample prayer sheet taken right from the Moms in Prayer website. All I did was select an attribute and hit print. It's like following a recipe. On this paper, you will find four steps of prayer. The format's the same each time. Praise, reading verses that relate to the attributes selected. Concentrating our prayers of praise according to what we've just read and heard from these verses. Second step is confession. That's always silent with the person to the Father. The third step is thanking God. We come in a time of thanksgiving. And then the fourth step is in intercession, praying on behalf of others. This step involves two parts. You can't see this, but every prayer sheet has a scripture verse that we pray for our children. There are fill in the blanks. We put our child's name in that blank, in that scripture verse, our grandchild's name in here, and we lift that up together in a scripture prayer for our children. And then we pray that specific request. Well, a natural byproduct of moms in prayer is that our relationship deepens. We grow in our relationship with God. We learn to love Him more and to trust Him more. And we come to understand what that close, abiding, intimate relationship it is that God wants to have for all of His children. Prayer changes us, and prayer changes things. On listening to radio during the week, I heard David Jeremiah, and he too was talking about praying for children in schools. So I conclude with this. He said, prayer, this is how you protect your children.
To pray for our school system, pray for our educators, pray for our kids. We need to lift them up now more than ever as they struggle through this current school year. So let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank you for the gift of this day. And thank you, Lord, for moms in prayer and opening up opportunities intentionally for moms and mothers across this state, across our nation, and throughout the world to be praying for their kids in school and all of our school systems. Lord, we ask for your richest blessings on our schools. Be with those who are in positions of authority, whether they be administrators or teachers, leaders in our school system. Grant them with your wisdom to be able to navigate through this school year in a way that's pleasing in your sight. We ask for your continued protection to be upon all of those who are employed by the school in any capacity. Lord, work through them in a mighty way to create an environment that's conducive to learning. And lastly, Lord, we take some time to lift up our students. Lord, we pray that they would feel safe at their schools, that, Lord, the schools would meet their educational needs, and that, God, as a church, that we would step up where we can to support them and encourage them and equip them as you shape them and mold them into who you've created them to be. God, we ask for your special blessings upon our schools, particularly here in Onslow County today, Lord. May you lead, guide, and direct all those involved, and may you be glorified through the school system. God, we love you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Saint, continue to worship this morning, church. One church, one church, one faith, one anthem raised. God and God alone. One cross, one grace, one name that saves. All praise to you belongs. All praise to you belongs. We lift you higher, higher. God and God alone, your name be louder, louder than any other song. You are forever seated on your throne. You are forever God and God alone. Who else? Who else can wash our sins away? God and God alone. Who else can raise us from that grave?
All praise to you belongs. All praise. All praise to you belongs. We lift you higher, higher. God and God alone, your name be louder, louder than any other song. You are forever seated on your throne. You are forever God and God alone. And what can separate us from this amazing love? And what can say is greater than our God? Every knee will bow down.
Sing it again. What could?
Oh, what can separate us from this amazing love? And what can say is greater than our God? Every knee will bow down. Oh, every knee will bow down. We lift you higher, higher. God and God alone, your name be louder, louder than any other song. You are forever seated on your throne. You are forever God and God alone. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. Child of God, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Whoa, whoa. Child of God, you You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Father God, we thank you this morning that you are here and you are in us. And Father, we thank you for what you have done and what you're going to do. And Father, as Pastor Mike brings the word today from 2 Timothy, Father, we are just humbled that you would invite us into your fold and that you would allow us to be called children of God. So, Father, I thank you for today. I thank you for who you are. Father, I thank you for who you call us to be. It's in your precious and your holy name that we pray. Amen.
As you're taking your seats, I want to invite you to open up your Bibles to the book of 2 Timothy. And we're kind of shaking things up a little bit. We've been in the middle of a sermon series through the book of Romans, and we're going to get back to that next week. Well, I don't even know which way is up right now. We're going to get back to that starting next week in chapter 11, but I wanted to take some time today to share with you something that's been on my heart for quite some time, and this is the opportunity that's most appropriate to be able to address as many people as possible. You know, during this pandemic, we've got folks that are watching from home. They're not able to participate in person. We live stream this. We broadcast it. We record it. It's posted. So our worship service is the time where I can really address the most people at once. And I felt like it was something that needed to be addressed. For the past 6 months, the COVID-19 pandemic has affected nearly every aspect of our life. I really can't think of anything that has not been in some way, shape, or form tainted in some way by this pandemic and our response to it. And that includes the life of our church. That includes the way we do ministry, the way we share the gospel. It's been radically altered during this season that we call a pandemic. In March, when the pandemic began here, we were forced to make some really difficult calls. We were forced seemingly overnight. Now, yes, there was some warning that it was coming, but nobody could possibly expect that it would end up where we are today. And we were forced to make a lot of decisions reacting to the news that was coming out about this pandemic and the rapid spread of a potentially fatal virus. We had to cancel and suspend our in-person worship services. We had to cancel Sunday school and suspend that, our Wednesday night activities. And at first we were thinking, all right, well, this is going to blow over and eventually we'll get back to normal. But as time has gone on, that's become more and more apparent that this thing is going to be here for a little while. And we've got to figure it out. As time has gone on, more and more events and activities and ministries had to be canceled or altered. We had huge plans for Easter. We had a Holy Week lined up, a Holy Week celebration culminating in Resurrection Sunday that all got put on the back burner. We had to do it virtually, and we made do with what we have. We had to cancel our vacation Bible school and rethink that. So we did a smaller version of that with some in-house kids that was COVID safe. Our summer camps for kids and students were canceled. And these decisions were very much a reaction and not a response to the situation that we found ourselves. There's a huge difference in reacting to something and responding to it. And let me put it to you this way. A reaction is something that's instantaneous. A reaction is something that you do kind of automatically when confronted with a situation. Think of it like you go to the doctor's office, they check your reflex, right? You're sitting there and they take that little rubber hammer and they bang it right below your kneecap, and what happens? Boom, your leg comes out. It's just this reaction that automatically happens. And that's sort of where we found ourselves. A response is different. Responding to something actually involves soaking in information and formulating a plan going forward, responding to adversity and adverse circumstances. I would argue that for the past 6 months, we've very much been in reaction mode as a church. So we've been functioning in such a way where we're trying to get back to normal, you know, and we're asking ourselves, all right, what can I reopen again? How can we get some semblance of normal here? And that's sort of how we've functioned. How can we get back to in-person worship? How can we get back to Sunday school the way we know it? And folks, what's been weighing on me and that I want to share today is this. The season of reacting to our circumstances has to come to an end. And we need to start responding. We need to start formulating a plan, understanding this is the context that we find ourselves in. COVID's not going anywhere anytime soon, but we still have a gospel to share. We still have a church that's supposed to reach its community. We still have a mission to love God, serve others, and make disciples. So now we've got to figure out how to do that, playing with the hand that we've been dealt. Today I'm going to be preaching from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. And I chose 2 Timothy because the theme of this book is directly applicable to the circumstances that we find ourselves in. 2 Timothy was Paul's second letter to his brother in the faith, his son in the faith. In fact, it calls him his beloved son. That's not biological. It was because that's how close they were. There was an intimate relationship with them. And at this time, Paul is in prison in Rome. And Timothy's in uncharted waters. He's in Ephesus on his own without his mentor, without his father figure in his life, trying to figure out how to plant churches and share the gospel. He was facing adversity. And Paul writes this letter to him, encouraging him to be bold in the faith, even in the face of adversity. And I think we can learn a lot of lessons from it. Today, we're going to be looking at chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. And here's the main idea I hope that we all come away with in our context today. And that is this. As Christians, we must guard against reactive ministry and be bold in the faith. We've got to guard ourselves against just reacting to what the world throws at us and be intentional and be bold about going forward and being intentional about the gospel. And at some point, we've got to flip that switch and we've got to do that. We've got to make sure that we're not just reacting to what's happening, but we're responding to it in an appropriate and safe way. And we're able to do that, folks, because of what we're going to see in verse 7. Because God's not given us a spirit of fear, but one of power, one of love, and one of self-control. And we're going to take some time to unpack that this morning. So I'm going to ask if you would, if you're able, please stand with me out of reverence for the reading of God's holy word. We're going to be in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. And it begins like this: Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, according to the promise of the life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve, as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you, that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, dwells in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has given us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Father in heaven, thank you for the gift of your word. And as we take time this morning to breathe in the truth that you breathed out in these scriptures today, Lord, we ask for your Holy Spirit to unlock our understanding. And God, it is my prayer as I stand before this assembly of believers that I've rightly divided your word of truth. I ask, Lord, that you would give me the wisdom and the boldness and confidence to speak your truth in love today. And may your truth transform our lives more into your likeness. God, we love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. You know, as we go back to the beginning of this, in the first four verses, this is a standard format for a letter in Paul's day. Today, when we write letters, we'll write, "Dear so-and-so," and then we have the body of the letter, and then we have our conclusion. Sincerely, and we sign our name. Back in Paul's day, it was a little bit different. The author of the letter would always introduce himself first. That's why it begins with, "Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God." This is Paul identifying himself as the author of the letter. The next part of a letter in Paul's day would be to whom that letter was sent. And here we see in verse 2, that is none other than Timothy. And Timothy was an understudy of Paul. They enjoyed a very close relationship. In fact, if you read 2 Timothy, you'll notice a lot of intimate details. There's a certain level of affection that we see in this letter that we don't see in other Pauline letters like Romans, like we're studying. There's a very intimate relationship there. So verses 1 through 4 are an introduction. And then look at verse 5. Verse 5, it's Paul is speaking and he says, I am reminded of your sincere faith. Paul is remembering as he's sitting there in a Roman prison that his beloved son in the faith, Timothy, has a genuine, real, authentic faith. And then he gives us another little bit of tidbit of information that we do well to understand. This sincere faith that he has is a faith that first dwelt in your grandmother Lois, then your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. And folks, that'll preach. We can take a lot of time just to unpack the truth in that, the value of family discipleship. Apparently, it was Timothy's grandmother who first came to know Jesus and was saved. And she witnessed to her daughter, Timothy's mother, Eunice, and who came to know Jesus for herself. And she invested the gospel into Timothy. And we do well as Christians today to be mindful of that model and the importance of doing discipleship in our home. But Paul's recognizing this. Paul's recognizing that Timothy is who he is because of this faith in Jesus that he knows personally, but was witnessed to and attested to by his family. Now, that's about all I'm going to spend on that this morning because I want to get to what happens next. Look in verse 6. For this reason, he's telling Timothy, because you have been raised up in the faith, because you have been discipled, because I know there's a sincere faith that dwells in you, look what he tells him. I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. That's kind of something that if we're not careful, we can miss. Paul is telling Timothy, you are responsible for fanning into flame the fire of God that's been planted inside you. That we as Christians bear responsibility in stoking the flames of our Christian faith on a day-by-day basis. It doesn't just happen automatically. We've got to feed the fire. We got to make sure we're spending time in the Word of God. We got to make sure we're spending time in prayer. We got to make sure that we're spending time with brothers and sisters in Christ who are sharpening one another in a spirit of discipleship. He tells him very clearly, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you. And then he says this. He reminds Timothy about the Spirit that God gives us. Now, this is not a capital S Spirit. This is not the Holy Spirit. In fact, the Greek word that's translated spirit here literally means a movement of air. And when you put that in a personal context, what that means is your demeanor, your attitude, the spirit that is about you. And he reminds Timothy in verse 7, for God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Now, your translation may say a spirit that's not of timidity. And that's a literal translation of what the intent here is of the author. That means that God has not given us a spirit of fearfulness, not one that is apprehensive or lacking confidence or unsure. That's not a spirit that's from God. That's not the spirit that God wants us to have, not our demeanor. Instead, he says, it's not of fear, but he's given us a spirit of power. That's the opposite of fear. That is the opposite of being timid. To have power is to have the resources necessary to accomplish the task set out before you. He says, God's not given us a spirit of timidity, of fear. He's given us a spirit of power. And additionally, he's given us also a spirit of love. That means to have a genuine affection for and concern for the well-being of others. That the spirit, the demeanor that God expects of us as believers of Timothy here in this text, in its direct context, literally means that God wants us to be caring for other people and to look out for their well-being and interest, and also a spirit of self-control. Now yours may say of sound mind. And it's an accurate translation. The idea behind that means that the spirit that God wants us to have, the demeanor that God wants us to have, is one of thoughtfulness, of intentionality, not reactive, but proactive. That he wants us to be mindful of the things that we're doing going forward. And folks, I think right now we are living in a time that we would all do well to heed Paul's message to Timothy. We would all do well to make sure that we are fanning into flame the gift of God. That we are feeding the fire that God has put inside us, because we need to be reminded that God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but a spirit of power, of love, and of self-control. And I think if we're being honest with ourselves, there has been a spirit of timidity that has crept into today's church. We have very much been walking on eggshells. We've been very unsure of ourselves as far as what can we do, what can't we do, what's appropriate to do right now, what's not appropriate to do right now. There's a whole bunch of questions and not a lot of answers. And because of that, we have this fear that's within us. And I don't mean fear as in being afraid. That's not what Paul's talking about here. This fearfulness, this timidity is one of unsurety. And here's what we know about that, church. It means that that's not from God. The unsure nature that we have is not the spirit that God wants us to have. He's given us a spirit not of that. Yet in our reaction, in what we've done in response to this COVID-19 pandemic, has been very much a reaction that's been based in fear. It's been based in uncertainty. It's been based in not knowing what we should do or what we shouldn't do. And that's just an honest examination of where we've been the last 6 months since this started in March. We began by just pulling the plug on worship. We had no idea what to expect, so we pulled the plug on in-person worship. We went 100% online. We were not going to forsake the assembly of the saints. We just assembled in a different way for a season. We got together and we worshiped online. Some folks are still doing that today. That is absolutely okay. We're still providing opportunities for people to do that. We pulled the plug on Sunday school in person. For a long time, we had no or very little intentional discipleship. We had a ladies group that was meeting. We had a D group that was meeting. We had a couple small groups that would meet kind of informally on their own for the purpose of discipleship. And for that, I am so thankful. But by and large, as a church, we essentially shut down all of our discipleship mechanism. It was a reaction to what was going on with this COVID-19 virus. Nursery and toddler care shut down. Even when we came back to in-person worship, we still don't have that. That's been a reaction to what's going on with this COVID pandemic. Our Wednesday nights shut down. Our Easter services were altered. Vacation Bible school didn't exist. Summer camp. But folks, remember this, because this is important. If we're going to get to be where God wants us to be, we have to remember that when we are fearful, when we are timid, that is not the spirit that God has put in. For God has not given us a spirit of timidity, but one of power, of love, and of self-control. So we've got to figure out what that looks like. What in the world does that look like? So let's take some time unpacking that. Here's the first one. God has given us a spirit of power. Power literally means having the authority and resources required to accomplish something. That's what power means. If you're powerless, you don't have the resources or ability to accomplish what's set out before you. If you do, you have power. That is the opposite of fear. And church, rather than asking the question, who are we and what do? We need to ask ourselves, whose are we? Who do we belong to? Because I don't know about you, but I belong to Jesus. I belong to the one true King. I'm a child of God, blood bought and redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. That's who we are. As a church, we are the bride of Christ. We are the church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. God has given us power to accomplish what it is He set out before us. Our mission as a church is unchanged. Our mission is to love God, to serve others, and to make disciples. Folks, that's not a dream. That's a calling. That's not something we aspire to do. That is our God-given mission as a church here at First Baptist Church in Richlands. And make no mistake about it, we can do all things through Him who gives us strength. We can love Him. We can serve others. We can make disciples. In fact, it's not optional. We need to be doing those things. We have to have a spirit within us that says, no matter what's happening in our lives, whether it's pandemic or anything else, nothing is going to stand in our way of loving God. Nothing is going to stand in our way of serving people. Nothing is going to stand in our way of making disciples. And we're able to make that bold claim because God has given us His Spirit of power. He's given that to us. But we also need to understand something else. He's given us a spirit of power, and He's also given us a spirit of love. And that's the second thing we need to know. God has given us a spirit of love. And the Bible, God's Word, has much to say about love. God Himself has revealed Himself to be love, right? That's in 1 John chapter 4. Jesus was asked, what is the most important commandment? What was His answer? To love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And He even went on to say, the second greatest commandment is just like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. Paul would write this in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13. So now faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. Folks, the Bible tells us that God has given us, look at verse 7 again. God has given us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. It doesn't say at some times this spirit that God wants us to have is one of power, and at other times it's a spirit of love, and at other times it's a spirit of self-control. The word and is there for a reason. God put it there. The spirit, the demeanor that God wants us to have is one of power, of love, of self-control, of all these things, right? So we've got to wrap our brains around that. That means we can't forsake one of these attributes of the Spirit that God wants us to have for the benefit of the other. We can't just lay claim to the Spirit of power and neglect the Spirit of love that God wants us to have. Nor can we embrace this Spirit of love that God wants us to have, but reject the Spirit of power. We've got to have all three, is what God tells us that we are to have. That means that as we strive to love God, serve others, and make disciples, we must do so boldly, but we also must do so lovingly. We must understand that we have the power of God and that we have a spirit of power, but we also need to understand that we exercise that power in loving ways, in ways where we love our neighbors. So we've got to balance those things. The last point I want to make is this. God has given us a spirit of self-control. Your translation may say of sound mind. There's a saying that has been around for a long time, and I don't know who first came up with it. Otherwise, I'd give them credit. I don't like to steal people's thoughts. But here's the quote, and I'm sure you've heard it. With great power comes great responsibility. Right? With great power comes great responsibility. And while we must be bold, while we must understand that God's given us a spirit of power, we must also be loving, and we must also exercise self-control. And I want to tell you something. As the shepherd of this flock, as the pastor of this church, that is the one thing of this that I struggle with the most, is the self-control. Because I'm a go-type guy. You know, I'll take my time gathering information and looking at things from all sorts of different sides and angles and viewpoints, but when a decision's made, I like to go 100 miles an hour in that direction. And what happens when you do that is you're not in control. I don't like this pandemic. And I'm not blaming the scientists. I'm not blaming the folks in charge. This is a brand new virus, right? We are just now, the best minds on the planet are starting to wrap their brains around and understand it. They're drawing medical conclusions that are sometimes conflicting, and it makes our job difficult. But we've got to listen to the best minds available, right? If it were up to me, if it were just, Mike Johnston, what do you want to do? I'd say, open it up. I'm tired of all this. I'm tired of reacting. I'm tired of being fearful. I'm tired of all this stuff. But folks, if we do that, you know what I'm doing? I'm embracing the power and I'm neglecting the self-control. We're neglecting the love. God wants us to have a spirit of all three of these things at the same time. That means we need to take the knowledge and information available and put it to use. And folks, that's wisdom. That's what wisdom is. Taking knowledge, gleaning information, and putting it to use is what wisdom is. And that's what we need to do if we're going to transition from reacting to what's going on in this pandemic and actually having an intentional response to it. We know enough now to be able to do that. We can respond boldly with a God-given spirit of power, of love, and self-control. So we've got to ask ourselves, what is our response going to be? That's where we need to get to now. And we've already started to do that in some aspects of ministry. We're going to start to do it a little bit more in others. Let me share with you some of the things that we've done already. Worship. Our initial reaction to worship was to just shut it down while we regrouped and figured out what was the most appropriate way to move forward in worship. We went completely virtual for a while. When we came to a conclusion that it was safe and appropriate to gather outside, we did that. If you remember, we had the big tic-tac-toe board painted out there on the ball field. Every family had their 10-foot square to sit in and set up your lawn chairs. And then as we learned more information about this, we realized, okay, it's safe to go ahead for some people who don't have underlying conditions to go ahead and worship together inside if we can keep our physical distance appropriate. And we have a beautiful facility here that allows us to be able to have families sitting together 6 feet apart all the way around. So we began to do that. And then what happened was when we were offering one worship service, we started to fill that one up and realized, okay, if we keep growing, we're going to have a problem here keeping our distance and we're not going to be doing what we're supposed to be doing. So we started another service, and that's in the sanctuary, and we've got it set up to where it's every other pew and we're able to keep our social distancing. Folks, worship is one of the areas that we have been intentional about and we have had a response to. It started with a reaction, but we transitioned to a response. But I have a message for you because I think a lot of you are in this boat. A lot of you right now are unsure whether it's okay to invite somebody to church right now. A lot of you are wondering, well, I know we're back in person, but I want to pressure anybody. I don't want to make them feel bad if they don't want to come. Let me tell you something. We've got room. If you want to invite somebody to come hear the gospel, if you want to invite somebody to participate in worship services, we have room. And I'll make a commitment to you. I'll make a commitment to every single one of you. If this gets full, we'll start another. If that service gets full, we'll start another. If we got to do 3 worship services, we'll do 3. If we got to do 4, we'll do 4. We'll do what we have to do to make sure that we can accommodate all the people that God wants to send to us. It is okay to invite somebody to church. I'd encourage you to do that. Invite them. Bring them on for what we've got going on. Our reaction to this COVID-19 pandemic when it came to discipleship was to close everything down. We shut down Sunday school. We shut down our midweek activities on Wednesday nights. We're starting to get to a place we're going to be opening that back up again. That's already started in a limited capacity. What we've done is we've made an opportunity for our senior adults, for our adults without kids, to have their Bible study time. Now, it's with masks. It's limited in number. It's all in one place. And what we're hearing and studying from the medical professionals, the best advice that we've got is that's a higher risk population that we need to do everything we can to keep them separated from families and more active people. That's what we're hearing. So here's what we're going to do, because we still have to make disciples of all people. We've got to find ways to get families involved. And families can't come for small group if we don't have anything for their children to go to. We've got to do all these things. We're going to continue to keep our 10 o'clock worship hour for senior adults in the adult wing. That's going to be a time for them. Starting on October the 7th, on Wednesday night, we will be having Sunday school and small groups and children's groups for families on Wednesday nights. We will have nursery available for that. We will have toddler care available for that. We're putting the final touches on that right now. We've got teachers in place that are willing to teach these classes. We've got nursery workers who are willing to do this. We can do it in an appropriate and safe way. I will say this, school-aged kids will wear masks in Sunday school. We're gonna mirror what they're doing in school, okay? So kids, school-aged kids are going to wear masks. Our adults are going to be wearing masks. It's not a big open space like this is. It's a confined classroom. So we're gonna take the appropriate safety measures. But starting on October 7th, we are going to have discipleship opportunities for anybody who wants to. Let me also say this. For some of you, that's not appropriate. Some of you have underlying conditions where you don't feel safe or comfortable gathering in a small group setting like that. let me make a commitment to you. You will not be browbeat into coming to this small group discipleship. If it is not the right decision for you and your family, that is absolutely okay. What we are doing as a church in response to this pandemic that we are finding ourselves in is we are making an opportunity for anybody who wants to be involved. And if you want to be involved, we want to invite you and encourage you to come and be part of what we're doing. We're going to be doing that through our Sunday school ministry. Starting next Sunday, during our 11 o'clock worship service, we will have infant and toddler care again. That will start to happen next week. So if you have a child who's 3 years old or under and you would like them to be cared for in our nursery, you'll be able to check them in. We have paid nursery workers. They'll be available starting next week. We're putting the finishing touches on those rooms right now. We've emptied those rooms. We are making a few changes from a physical standpoint to make sure we can spread these kids out as much as possible. We're getting pack and plays put in there that we can fold up out of the way if we need to. We've got all sorts of different stuff happening, but starting next week during the worship, during the 11 o'clock worship service, we will have infant and toddler care available. The pumpkin patch. The pumpkin patch is something that we're taking an intentional response to. My first reaction to the pumpkin patch was, when it got time to do it, was like, no, probably just not a good idea to do it. But we're changing our tune a little bit. We are going to be doing the pumpkin patch, but it's going to look different this year. And here's the main reason why we're going to do it the way we're going to do it. We're doing it for a 2-week period. We're doing it for less hours during the day. But here's why we can't cancel it. That's not what God wants us to do. We still need to reach out to our community. That is a very difficult thing to do when you're supposed to have limited contact with people outside of your household, right? The pumpkin patch is a prime opportunity where we don't have to go to people. People come to us, and we can witness to them. We can love them. I know over the years we've kind of gotten to this place where we think the pumpkin patch is about making money for the kids. It's a fundraiser for kids to go to camp. That's a side effect. That's a good benefit of it. But that's not why we should do the pumpkin patch. We should do the pumpkin patch because it gives us an opportunity to love on people and build relationships. Invite them and encourage them to be part of what God's doing here at First Baptist Church. That's going to be the primary mission of our pumpkin patch this year. Every single person who comes here to First Baptist Church is going to leave with some information about our church and hopefully have heard the gospel from one of our workers and volunteers. There's going to be a training for this, all right? There are sign-up sheets available on that back wall. I want to encourage each and every one of you to sign up for at least one slot. Guys, we're doing this for 2 weeks. The hours are posted on there, and the more people we can have involved in this ministry, the merrier. You do not have to be a member of First Baptist Church to sign up for this. You can be involved in it even if you're not. The proceeds for this will go to our students and our kids going to camp. But that, like I said, that's a side effect of it. That's a side benefit. The primary goal of this is to engage people in conversation and relationships. So that's what we're looking to do with it. Thursday and Friday of this week, our offices will be closed here at the church. Our staff is going to be shutting down the office, and we're going to take those 2 days to plan our calendar for 2021. And we're looking at it through a different lens. The last 6 months, we've been looking at it as, how can we get back to where we were? What we are going to be doing is laying out a plan for 2021, knowing the conditions that we face. How can we love God, serve others, and make disciples in the current climate? And you know what? If this thing goes past us and the restrictions ease up, we can always build it back up. But we need to have a plan in place to be able to do what God has called us to do in the current climate we find ourselves in. We can't just react anymore and say, well, we wanted to do this, but now we can't, so we're just going to have to cancel it. No, we got to be better than that. We got to have a spirit that God has given us, one of power, of love, and of self-control. And we can do all of those things. And we will do all of these things. Folks, we're going to have a time this morning of invitation and response, just like we always do. And I know this has been a bit of a different type of message. But before I close out, I do want to say this. I am so thankful that I know Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. This pandemic is not a surprise to Him. I can't imagine what it would be like facing the uncertainty and facing all this stuff without knowing that Jesus has me in this. And if that's you, that can change today. you're not alone in this. You don't have to walk alone in this. The uncertainty and the timidity and the fear that you feel right now, you will always feel unless you know God and have a relationship with Him through Jesus Christ by accepting Him as your Lord and Savior. So as we have a time of response this morning, if you need to make that decision, then I want to invite you to come up and let me pray with you and talk with you about how you can be saved today, how you can experience the same spirit that it was put in Timothy, a spirit that's not of fear, but of power, of love, and of self-control. Folks, as we have a time of response and a time of invitation today, I want to ask you, what is it that God's calling you to do? Maybe you've been so focused on the power of this that you forgot that God wants us to love people. Maybe you've been so focused on love that you've neglected to do what God's calling you to do and stepping up and being bold in your faith. Folks, we need to be all these things. And if you're a Christian sitting here today, I want to ask you, what is it that you need to do? What is it that God is calling you to do? Maybe He's calling you to be bold in your faith by joining this body of believers. Maybe He's calling you to have a spirit of love and to get plugged into the ministries of this church by moving your membership here. Maybe He's calling you to a spirit of self-control where you need to realize, you know what? I've been reacting and I need to actually plan and I need to be doing what God wants me to do rather than just putting out fires every 5 minutes. I don't know what God's calling you to do, but I know He's calling you. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes and simply say, God, what it is that you want from me? Here I am. Lord, as we come humbly before you today, we come also boldly. We come in love and we come completely within control. And God, we submit ourselves humbly before your throne of grace. And God, we know your word tells us that you humble the proud and you exalt the humble. And Lord, we are humbled before you. Help us to go forward as a church in a way that's pleasing in your sight. Help us to turn away from just reacting to things and be intentional about what we do moving forward. God, help us to understand that things may look different right now, but at the end of the day, we seek to honor you, not tradition. We seek to serve others in a way that's pleasing to you, that they may come to know you. We seek to make disciples because you command us to do that. But above all, God, you command us to love you with every fiber of our being. Whether it's a pandemic or any other thing the devil may throw at us here in this life, God, help us to always be confident in your gospel. And as you open doors for us to share the gospel and witness to others, help us to bust through those doors and be faithful servants of you. God, we ask for your spirit to be upon us. And God, as we have a time to respond to your word today, I ask that your Holy Spirit would speak to us clearly. And as you call us, God, may we be willing to follow you wherever you lead us. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand and respond this morning?
Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like a fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. There's something about that name. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, like a fragrance after the rain. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Amen. I'm going to ask if you would please go ahead and take your seats again. And I'm going to ask if you would to please remain there until one of our deacons, one of our ushers comes get you. You can go out either door here. The sign-up sheets for the pumpkin patch, there's only one of them, so there was no overlap. They're available at the back there. The sign-up sheets for the picture directory that we're doing is at that welcome table right there. But folks, we're so glad you're here today. I hope you're mindful of the announcements that were made this morning. Members of the church, I do want to invite you tonight to come back 6 o'clock in the sanctuary for our church conference. But as we depart from here, let's go with a word of prayer together. Father in heaven, thank you for the gift of this Lord's Day. We're so thankful for the spirit that you've given us, the spirit of power and love and of self-control. And in these coming days and months and throughout the rest of our lives, Lord, lead us and guide us according to your spirit that you've put in us. Lord, as we depart from this place, we ask for your protection. We ask, Lord, that the things we say and do might bring honor and glory to you, so everybody we encounter might see you in us. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.